So my name is Evelyn Farkas. I'm a non-resident senior fellow at the Atlantic Council. I just finished 3 years as Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Russia, Ukraine, Eurasia, but very much engaged with the Baltic neighbors and friends and allies for obvious reasons. And so I'm very excited to be able to share this or moderate this meeting this morning. And the other reason is because what's not in the job title is it's Russian, Ukraine, Eurasia, and it includes the Caucasus, the Balkans, so all of the five aspirin states, Georgia, as well as the Balkan aspirin states, were also in that office, are in that office. So when I think about Warsaw, I think about a lot of issues, including issues such as enlargement. So I know you have not touched upon that yet this morning. I don't know whether the other panels touched upon that, but that would be one thing that I will ask about. But really, this is the forward-looking panel, the kind of what do we expect to get out of Warsaw in this summer. I think it merits, and I will be interested in hearing from the panelists about what they think the environment will be like leading up to Warsaw, because it's not just the summit itself, it's the lead up to the summit. We will have a very significant exercise occurring in Poland this summer in June called Anaconda. Many of you are very familiar with it. 25,000, I believe, troops. Of those, 13,000 will be US, and there are about 20, 25 different countries participating in it. I think that our Russian colleagues will take note of this, and generally speaking, because they tend to overreact to our normal exercises that we very transparently, you know, transmit ahead of time. We explain what they are and why we're doing them, but they tend to react out of proportion with what we're doing. So I think I would be interested to see, you know, what the panel thinks about the likelihood of Russian reactions, how the Russians might react. But this summit is truly historic, and we have a lot of unfinished business to complete from Wales, but also going forward, obviously dealing with the eastern flank and all the other issues that some of which have been touched upon, some of which will be touched upon. So let me not speak any further. I think you all are here for the panelists. I will introduce them briefly, and then I will ask each of them to speak for about 5 minutes. Then I will take the moderator's prerogative and ask a few questions, and I will give you some hints. And then, of course, open it up to the audience for questioning and discussion. So, to my left, I'm very pleased to introduce to you the Minister of Defense for Lithuania, Minister Olekas, who has been also a member of Parliament. You have been previously that's right, because you spoke earlier. Okay, well, so you are very familiar with the distinguished minister, but I also want to take a moment to really thank the minister and his government for helping us with this event, for being a very active partner, and for the Atlantic Council. This is a fantastic opportunity to highlight some of the work that we've been doing, but also to focus more specifically on the Baltics and to work more closely with Lithuania. So I, if you permit me, I will make that editorial comment. To his left, of course, is the Honorable Ellen Tauscher, who is very well known up here on Capitol Hill because she served a long time from 1997 to 2009 as a distinguished member of the House of Representatives. And she was she served on the House Armed Services Committee, which was a significant responsibility, but also on the Transportation and Infrastructure Committee. She was chairman of the House Armed Services Committee on Strategic Forces, so I may have a few questions when we get to the open Q&A pertaining to strategic issues. She went on to then serve in the administration. She was nominated by President Obama to serve as Undersecretary of State for Arms Control and International Security, and she held that position from 2009 to early 2012 and served at a critical time for the administration. I won't go into all of her other distinguished accomplishments. She serves on lots of boards. I think the most important thing from the perspective of the Atlantic Council is, of course, that she's on the board of the Atlantic Council, and she is, I believe, the...
Thank you. Thank you, Evelyn, and thank you, the previous panelists, for well done, I think, discussion and answering to the questions. Regarding your question, what will be the situation around the Warsaw Summit, I think it's not easy to predict, but of course we can follow that is a good use. You mentioned that we will have exercises in Poland.
Exercise is on the our reaction, and I think the very accurate reaction what is going in this region. Maybe you know or not that we had on other side of our borders in the region the exercise which much higher numbers of soldiers in the exercises Zapad 2009, exercise Zapad 2013. It was include about 60 or 80 thousand soldiers from Russia and from Belarus, and this is normal reaction in the region. I think this is what we created, this was Cody mentioned before that is our normal reaction on Russian behaviors in the region. And I think this is very important. And from my point of view, the NATO is on the right track. And well summit and readiness action program proved once again that we are able to redefine the alliance and react on the new threats. And this time the alliance is very important, and transatlantic link is more important than ever since the end of Cold War. And maybe we can say that this also there are bad news that situation in the region is not become better. The aggression of Russia continue, the terrorism and instability is spreading, and we should keep in mind this situation, this challenges and threats. And as I said previously in my introduction and speaking, that being a medical doctor, I also looking how we should treat these diseases. We can say that diseases of Russia, threat and aggression, how it should be treated. It should be treated specifically, and we have ideas on previous plenary session that we should have capabilities, we should have the readiness, and also we should have the C2 command and control according to this situation. And if I may say that the first what we should have in the Warsaw, we should agree that enhanced forward presence is indeed very important and very specifically to this region, to defend and to deter, not to leave the vacuum for security for the Russia provocation. And I think Mr. Kubilius mentioned that it's more provocative for Russia is the weakness. And we should not leave this possibility to think that there are some weakness in the Baltic space and another place. And I think that it's very important that it was mentioned that we have the activities from the United States, the engagement, the ERI, and other initiatives, and we have the NATO plans and activities, but we also should have and implement our national or European activities in this situation. And first of all, we fully agree that for these activities, for readiness, for capabilities, we need the resources. And the spending, especially in the Baltic states, Estonia, which reached the 2% previously, but now the Lithuania and also the Latvia, we have on the track to reach 2% as soon as possible. And we try to use these resources, these expenditures, as effective as we can in the context with the United States, trying to fulfill some shortages, shortfalls where we have. It was mentioned that anti-tank, anti-area defense systems and other. And this is real, what we should implement to do and to prepare, and also the host nation support for the troops coming to our countries. And summarize, I think that it will be the, as you said, the historical summit where we can adopt our capabilities to the new geopolitical situation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Evelyn. It's great to be here. I've been in the private sector now for 3 years, so it's always nice to come back and talk about these issues. I almost wish that in my 3 years of being gone, you'd all solve them. But apparently, we need to continue working on some of these things. As Evelyn said, I spent 7 terms in the Congress representing the East Bay of San Francisco. Anybody ever been to Walnut Creek, California? Okay, that's where I'm from. And I left after
my 7th term to become Under Secretary of State for Arms Control. The Obama administration was coming in, Secretary Clinton was coming in as Secretary of State, and I think everybody looked up and realized that we had the nasty and unfortunate circumstance of the calendar, that the START treaty was going to expire in 10 months, and we had nothing really ready from the previous administration to negotiate a treaty. As you know, a treaty art is about a 28-month routine to get a treaty done. That's assuming everybody wants to do it, and we were not in a posture to do that, so we scrambled. And our team in Geneva and the Russian team, we ended up getting a treaty a few months after the deadline had passed, and in a very unusual circumstance of the lame duck Congress in December of 2010, because President Obama was determined to get the treaty, Secretary Clinton and actually Secretary Gates worked very, very hard to make sure that we were able to get a lame duck Congress where the Democrats had lost the House to get Republican votes to get 2/3 to ratify the treaty in December of 2010. So we've had the 5th anniversary, which is very nice. But I spent a lot of time with the Russians. I still spend time talking to Russians. And I will tell you that as I look back over the end of the Cold War and the circumstances we find ourselves in now, this is the same problem that we knew we had at the end of the Cold War. There are many people inside of the Russian establishments, particularly in the Kremlin, that really don't trust us. And very little, I think, was done on their side, and certainly perhaps as recognition from our side, that we really had to work on the areas of trust. When I tried to leave as Undersecretary for good, I ended up staying for about a year as a special envoy for strategic stability and missile defense. I was well known for my posture on missile defense as chairman of strategic forces on the Armed Services Committee, which is a $55 billion portfolio that includes the nuclear weapons, space satellites, architecture and missile defense.
My father used to call me Missile Girl. And I found it just astounding that I would sit across the table from Russian colleagues, mostly from the military side, who liked me and respected me but didn't believe a word I was telling them about missile defense. That, of course, while I posed it, posed was the word that I always found to be a little offensive, I posed it as a defensive system. Of course, it was clearly an offensive system. And even when I tried to remind them that I might be lying, but science doesn't, and missile defense is all about physics, and as a science, physics doesn't lie. Let me show you how this works. They just couldn't believe me. And so we remain in this new century, in the second decade of this new century, in the same position we were in 1950, where we have opposing sides that for mostly ideological reasons, facts don't matter. And that's so disappointing to me, because we have to move beyond that. And so we have this great summit coming up, and I just wanted to very briefly talk about some ideas that I wanted to share that we have at the Atlantic Council. Of things that people can consider going forward. And I think what's really important is we need to have NATO and the EU integrate a lot more, not only on strategic narrative, but on the whole idea of planning and funding. Corey was terrific when she said that a 2% investment for national security and defense by our NATO partners is meant to be a floor. I think we have to remember that for many of our NATO colleagues, they've got to come out of the basement to get to the first floor. This is not a question of increasing to 2%. I'd just like to stop the bleed. I'd like it to stop going down below 1%. And so we have to do two things. We've got to stop it from going down and then get some people to understand that they've got to move it up. And that this has got to be part of the strategic narrative. What I worry about is that if you took a walk down the street and walked into 10 Americans that were coming here for a tour at the Capitol from different parts of the country and asked them about NATO, you would get 10 very uninformed answers. If you ask them about Article 5, which was the big problem in the very birth of NATO, the American people, exhausted from the Second World War, did not want to have anything in the NATO agreement that caused them to immediately have mutual aid and assistance back in Europe. They wanted to be home and stay home. But when was Article 5 ever enacted? Oh, it was enacted once on the behalf of the United States on the evening of September 11th of 2001. I cried. I was crying anyhow. But most Americans don't even know that the combat air patrols that protected the East Coast 11 hours after the first plane hit came from Europe as part of NATO's response to invoking Article 5. People don't know. Now, that's a shame, because when you need political capital to get the Congress to vote for things to a place where it not only serves as an active deterrent, but it is also a sense of projecting our values and keeping us together. So let me just very quickly say that we've got a couple of things that we should do. One, obviously, is to deal with making sure that NATO and the EU have a much more congruent sense of planning, working together, understanding exactly how we are going to deal with burden sharing. You know, in Warsaw, I think European allies should work creatively and resourcefully to develop a realistic counterpart to our ERI. Whereas the previous panel, you know, Jim and Frank and Tori, Corey said, more of a sense of a multinational force that can be easily deployed. We also want to make sure that the spending piece is dealt with, I think, frankly. And part of it shouldn't be, I'll do my best, or I'd really like to try, or we have other priorities. Our strategic message should be, this is the national priority of every one of our allies. And if you can't make it move this year, tell me how you're going to do it next year. Tell me what your budget posture is going to be. We here in the United States, I mean, I used to say to my Russian counterparts, well, if you don't trust me, that's fine. All you have to do is read the National Defense Bill. All you have to do is read the Appropriations Bill. I'm telling you what I'm spending money on. This is not a secret. And you may not like me or trust me, but the American people demand that we have transparency in our budgeting process. And unlike the intelligence agencies, which can kind of do it behind the screen, we're not allowed to do that. So our investment posture is very, very well known. And investment posture is about your values. And so what we have to say to our allies are, don't tell me what you want me to do for you. Tell me what you're doing for us. Let's get back to the posture of thinking of us. And when I see your investment in security go up, then I will believe it's important to you. Because you can't be spending my money to protect you. Because as everybody has, I think, rationalized, it can't mean more to me than it does to you. And so the last thing I think we need to do is I think my friend Federica Mogherini, who's the high representative in Europe, you know, she's got a new plan coming out for EU global strategy, which is going to get released just before the Warsaw meeting. And I think what is important is that there is a congruency between what that plan is. And I would urge my European friends to sit down and let's start to mark that up as best we can and make sure that there is a real congruency between what we're saying in NATO strategically, what your EU is saying, because as long as we look even slightly divided or slightly distracted, others will be able to change the narrative, assume the narrative, or take us for what we are, slightly distracted. And so we have to have, I think, not only the rhetorical piece of this and the investment piece of this, but we have to have a strategic piece that we can point to and really have a roadmap for the investment strategy, countries making pledges to increase their defense spending over the next 5 years. Even if it's marginal, we have to have a situation where we're showing people that we're committed. I sit on a few boards of charity organizations, and the first thing, if you're going to a big American or European funder, the first thing they want to know is, has everybody on the board written a check? It might be something that everybody thinks is a great idea and they want to invest in, but they're not going to invest unless you've invested. And so in our case, we all have to be responsible. We have two of the best friends that the Americans have ever had sitting here. Of course, I'm Irish. I could find the Irish ambassador if I wanted to, but I want to thank my friends from Lithuania and Estonia, and frankly, all of my NATO colleagues for their hard work and their determination. These are tough times. These are very, very tough times. There's a tremendous amount of provocation out there. There's a tremendous amount of instability and projection of instability. And what we have to do is unite, come up with a common strategy, project it, make the investment strategy, and speak together in a very congruent, determined way. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Tauscher. That was great.
Very rousing. And I think now maybe we're a little bit more motivated and energized to hear some more interesting details. But I just want to point out a couple of things I like that you said.
You talked about facts mattering. I feel very strongly that that is the key to our success and what differentiates us in every way, or in the most significant way, from the Russian regime, the current Russian regime. And again, getting back to my question about our exercises, and you very, very well, Mr. Minister, pointed out the difference, not just in the transparency and in projecting ahead of time why we're conducting them, but also in the size and the fact that some of these snap exercises in the past have been used as a prelude to invasion. So I think this facts mattering is really important. I also very much appreciated you talking about projecting our values, because again, when I talk about NATO expansion or even strengthening NATO, what we're doing is projecting our values to the world, and of course, in doing so, strengthening ourselves. And then let's get back to the posture of thinking about us. I think that's a really good catchphrase, if you will, maybe for this panel. We'll see whether maybe the secretary can outdo it. But I think these are very good principles. So with those in our heads, let me turn it over to the permanent secretary.
Thank you so much. And there is no way I can outdo that. So I agree with everything that was said. And before I offer my very brief remarks, in the hope of receiving questions that are of interest to you, I want to thank the Atlantic Council for convening this event. And this is me as a government official, I'm a bureaucrat speaking here. One of the crucial preconditions for success in every political process is gain or regain initiative. And that requires proactive thinking forward to the future, oftentimes long term. And again, as a government official, we bureaucrats are not really great at that. Oftentimes, we are surprised by even the most obvious developments that take place around us. And this is where we rely on our academic and our colleagues and our colleagues from Finland. The work that the Atlantic Council has been doing over the past few years is really significant. We are grateful for that as Europeans, and we are grateful for that as Estonians, and we hope that you will continue doing this work, and we hope that everybody on the Hill listens to what the Atlantic Council very wisely is suggesting.
Thank you for that plug.
So it is truly an honor to be here. And now, I agree with everything that has been said before. I just highlight a few points. The challenge that we're facing in Europe, in the eastern part of Europe, is a long-term challenge. And in face of this, we need a credible, long-term, stable defense and deterrence motion. Now, I'll be very clear, this is what we're working on. We're not trying to be aggressive. We are not trying to assure ourselves that our kapag works. We know our kapag works. We don't need that assurance. We're trying to build up a credible, long-term, stable defense and deterrence posture. Defense and deterrence are linked. We want to make sure nobody miscalculates regarding the red lines from Article 5 is and Article 5 is not. Now, our strategy, semi-strategy, has always been based in two pillars. First, our own self-defense capabilities, and secondly, the international aspect of our defense. Now, we've been at 2%, actually about 2% for a few years now. We hope everybody recognizes that we really do put our money where our mouth is. We have contributed to operations. We have put money towards our defense capabilities. I think we're in the top 4 or 5 nations in NATO when it comes to per capita defense spending. A few years ago, 2012, 2013, when we approved our last long-term defense development document, that's the main document that guides us in figuring out what kind of military we think we need and what kind of military we can afford. Our budget was growing during some years by 20%, and at the same time we cut our structure from basically 5 brigade headquarters to 2, not because of lack of money, but because of a clear understanding that the power force, a force that looks great on paper, that is big on paper, does nothing for you when you actually need to defend yourself. Now that 2%, actually above 2% of GDP sounds great, but defense does not work on a per capita basis. I can't buy a single company or a battalion, a single javelin missile or a Raytheon radar with percentages. I only use actual euros and dollars for that. And because of the very small size of the nation, actually all the people nations, a very particular geographic, geostrategic region of rain, there is no way we can defend and also deter without the international power. Now, traditionally, since 2004, when we joined NATO, that international part has always been based on positive reinforcement. Something starts to happen, we get early work. We start defending ourselves and at the same time start moving in larger formations from allied nations. And then get there on time, start defending. And hopefully, through this, also deter aggression in the first place. Because again, to a large extent geography, but also the capabilities that we see around us, that reinforcement-based strategy simply does not work for defense, and hence also for a credible deterrence posture. Reinforcement continues to be important. It's important that we have the forces, that we have the plans, that we have the infrastructure, that we conduct exercises, making sure that we can actually move forces around. But without credible forward presence in the Baltic states, it simply does not work. Now that forward presence needs to be militarily credible and needs to be politically credible. Politically credible, in a slightly oversimplified way, means multinational, and military credible does not mean that they need to be able to defeat incursions or other things people can come up with in scenarios. But at least be able to communicate to everybody who is looking and paying attention that there is no way you can conduct an incursion without at least fighting that allied presence in all parts of the allied territory. Now, in Wales, NATO recognized the importance of working this problem. It created a number of measures that have been put in place and implemented.
Also in the Baltic states. We are politically midway between Wales and Warsaw, where I can see consensus growing between the civilian world and the military world, between the different bureaucracies and different allies, between the different political systems within the West, that this is a matter that needs to be taken seriously for the long term, and that the recipe does consist of reinforcement as well as presence. So I'm very optimistic when it comes to Warsaw. I'm almost positive that the decisions that have to be made will be made. Now, as a final remark, I'll say that we in the West, we oftentimes have a tendency of declaring history to be over for some reason. When that article was written in 1989, we were still occupied. Mm-hmm. History never ends. And in international organizations, every summit obviously is a success, but there is also a tendency to believe that history ends with the next summit. I remember that throughout my career at the Ministry of Defense, and we've been in NATO only since 2004. Every summit is a great success story and the end of the road. This is never the case. It wasn't the case in Wales. It's not going to be the case in Warsaw. We will not be able to solve history with one summit. We'll be able to make a number of good decisions, but we'll probably have to continue paying attention to these challenges even after Warsaw in the years and decades to come. That will not be doable without political support in each and every one of the Allies' capitals. And speaking here on the Hill, that political support to a large extent is dependent upon the Congress and the level of support here. Throughout the Soviet occupation, it was always Congress that led the way. When it came to non-recognition policy in the 1990s, when it came to helping us on our way towards NATO, I'm sure that Congress will lead the way when it comes to these challenges as well, and in cases where applicable, explain to the constituencies the importance of NATO, the importance of the transatlantic relationship, and the fact that this is indeed not just the United States coming in to assist Europeans, but if necessary, the Europeans always coming to not only demonstrate, but really actively support the United States. Thank you.
That was fantastic. And I think, obviously, probably music to Secretary Tauscher's ears. Again, praise for Congress, because we don't often hear that. And if I could be autobiographical as well, I spent half of my Washington career actually in the Senate, working as a professional staff member. But what I want to say is, actually, as a former administration official, we very much relied on Congress for all of the support, all of this funding for ERI, all of the, frankly, the pressure that Congress puts on the administration. You know, what are you doing? Can you do more? You know, that is very constructive and very helpful. So I say now, as a former administration official, keep up the good work and keep pressuring, for those of you working here on the Hill, keep pressuring our government, because it's very important. But obviously, the without the funding that Congress provides, nothing can happen. But the political support is key, and the messaging that Congress provides when members of Congress show up at things like the Munich Security Conference and other platforms and speak out about America's commitment is heard and very much appreciated. So thank you for those words, and it's very fitting here in this environment. So I have a couple of questions, but I don't want to monopolize too much time. So what I'm going to do is, my first question, in the spirit of what Secretary Tauscher said, you know, let's get back to the posture of thinking about us, I would like to address one of the sub-questions that my colleagues at the Atlantic Council very helpfully provided for us here, which is, okay, so you, and I'm going to address this to the Minister and to the Permanent Secretary, we are now part of one alliance together. So clearly for you, the existential issue, obviously, is the situation in the East with Russia and provocative stance and posture and doctrine, et cetera, policy. But you have other allies for whom the immediate urgent threat is terrorism, is the immediate urgent problem to be solved is the refugee flow that stems from the fighting in the Middle East with the extremist, radical, Islamist terrorists. So how do you answer the question of how should NATO balance these two different but equally important, if you will, threats to the alliance? How do you answer the question of those who are looking from the outside saying, well, the Baltics, they're not going to care about terrorists, or the French aren't going to contribute as much to the eastern flank? So if I could ask Mr. Minister a few brief words and then turn it to the Secretary, and then I have a question also for Secretary Tauscher.
Thank you, you very much. Indeed, this is, we saw these challenges in different part of the world. As I said in previous period, you should look on 360 degrees what is going on, and should be ready. The NATO is a strong alliance. We cannot say that we can bomb or manage just only one challenge in the world.
You say America will walk and chew gum.
Yeah, according to our strategy, we are alliance which is can act in different phases of the world. And I think, yes, the problems in the South, they are realistic challenges and problems. And we should allocate our
try to solve this problem, should be active, and we participate in the different lives. We have been in the Afghanistan and Iraq for about 10 years, sending our special operation forces, leading our PRT in the as the same in the South now. But we have the specific problems and threats in the East. We should found a specific, as I said, medicine or treatment for South problems and a specific treatment for the East. And on our discussion on the panels, we found what we needed in the East. It's different what we need to how we should act in the South. And we should share. We should share these problems and should act together and in balanced matter in South and in the East.
Okay, Mr. Secretary.
Well, I absolutely concur. There's no question that NATO needs to be active. We have a 360-degree defense approach. The challenges are different. They're equally serious,
and they keep on changing, as you know. We know, but we do have to walk and chew gum at the same time. There's no question about it. You know, the flower I'm wearing and my colleagues are wearing here. This is our Veterans Day is approaching. Mm-hmm. So for a few weeks before the Veterans Day, we wear the flower to commemorate the ones we've lost and the people who were wounded in you know, in Afghanistan and Iraq. When I look at the problem of the South and the East, and then I do read about it in the press, I hear about it at events like this, but when I look at actual, you know, actions, then the problem doesn't seem that significant. I look at Baltic Air policing, and I see the Portuguese and the Turks and the Italians and the Spaniards contributing significantly. And I look at our own operations, and those of Lithuania, for instance, or Latvia, who is not here at the table today, but you know, our operations are in the Middle East and in Africa and in Afghanistan. So we can see that in reality, nations are investing into a 360-degree defensive posture. And the flowers that we wear are a testament of that. None of the soldiers we've lost were lost, you know, fighting in Estonia. So I hope people recognize that. Mm-hmm. And I'm quite confident that as an alliance, I mean, this has always been a deal between nations that may not share a geographic position, that may face different challenges, but nations that share fundamental values and interests. And this has been a deal between those nations that we will be willing to invest in our allies' security in return of the allies investing in our security, because together we are stronger. And that, I think, basic fundamental deal that was valid in 1949 continues to be valid today. And we've been successful. We'll continue to be successful in the future as well.
Thank you very much.
Those are fantastic responses, going from general to even more specific examples. And I think, again, it gets back to what you said earlier, Secretary Tauscher, about projecting our values. So if I could very quickly ask you for your thoughts on what should be on the Warsaw agenda with regard to nuclear or nuclear policy. Do you think that NATO has given enough thought to the future with regard to nuclear policy? How concerned are you about the Russians breaking out of the INF Treaty? It's a lot, but you can pick whatever you would like to address.
My area of California, I represent the only congressional district with two national nuclear weapons labs in it, Lawrence Livermore and Sandia, California. So I came from the private sector when I didn't take my medication on time one day and decided to run for Congress. And I ran in a Republican district as a Democrat. but I meet them mostly because I had spent 17 years as a small child on Wall Street, but also because I went to the lab during what was, I had a nominal primary opposition, because nobody thought this guy could be beaten. And I went to the lab twice, and there were 10,000 people there. It was the largest employer in the district.
But it had been, never had anybody from its congressional district sit on the committee of jurisdiction. And it's amazing what you do when you pay attention to people, they actually kind of respond. And so I became the member of Congress, and I went on to the Armed Services Committee, and I became the chairman of the committee that has jurisdiction over the weapons labs. That's no good deed goes unpunished for that, because there's not a lot of people that want to spend their time thinking about these issues. But you know, I think our nuclear posture is fundamentally important, especially because it is a fundamental pillar of the NATO alliance. Our projection of our deterrence to allies, both in Asia and in Europe, is a significant commitment. And it has caused us to spend hundreds of billions of dollars over many years maintaining a strategic force of nuclear weapons that is safe, reliable, and effective, and that, and to which there is no question that they work. Now, the question of whether you're going to use those weapons or not is a political question. I would tell you that I believe that, except for some key strategic points, nuclear weapons are political weapons these days. They are political weapons in Europe. And our force in Europe, the tactical force in Europe, is a political statement. It is a defense commitment. And they have to be balanced so that people understand exactly what they mean. And so it's important for us to be able to tell people that need to hear what they mean, so that they actually believe in our credibility and they actually believe that they are there to do a number of different things. But on the political side, what they're really meant to do is to provide our allies with a commitment that is really outsized. It's a big commitment. And so, you know, the question of whether we should still have tactical nuclear weapons in Europe, I'm leaning against it, but I'm not moving them now. I'm certainly not moving them now when there's so much provocation from the other nuclear, big nuclear power. And so, you know, I'm disappointed that we are in a position where we have nuclear weapons in Europe that I believe we should consider having the political conversation with our allies, having our allies talk to their peoples in parliaments so that they would understand what a withdrawal of those weapons would be. But this is not the right time to do it. I'm certainly not going to do something like this at a time when Russia has had so many gains in their mind, and when they have redrawn maps in Europe for the first time in 70 years, and when they are modernizing their force. So I feel as if activities, if you remember the president's Prague speech in April of 2009, he said that he wanted to have nuclear weapons de-emphasized, that he actually wanted to take weapons down to zero. He didn't expect it would happen in his lifetime, and that it was going to take a while to socialize people on it. But we are now, in 2016, not in a place where we were perhaps in 2008 or 9, where we could have actually had a conversation, because I think it sends the wrong signal to consider moving the weapons out of Europe now. That is a huge disappointment to me, because I do believe that these are not necessarily weapons that we're ever going to use on a battlefield, and I certainly don't want terrorists or other bad guys thinking that they can get their hands on them. So we've kind of gone back to the future, unfortunately. We're not in a time now where we have the kind of stability that we can talk about these issues. But I think it's important that we keep these commitments as the United States so that our friends and allies don't have a second of confusion. But we're not talking about it. I mean, Evelyn just asked me, you know, a pretty provocative question. It's not really a topic. You know, I would hope that our friends in the European press and our allies and our friends in the European part of the alliance and their parliaments would start to talk about it. Because I think it is an important issue. This is about security and safety. I don't think that nuclear weapons provide anything but a deterrent factor these days. I think it's a necessary one considering the provocation. I wish that we didn't. I wish we were in a different place right now where we actually could bring them home. But I don't think we can because of Russia's provocations.
Well, thank you very much. Now you've dispirited us somewhat, but I think I wanted to make sure that somehow the nuclear issues also were part of the conversation today. I know, of course, NATO experts, and you already heard from some of our NATO officials earlier today, sitting in the front row here, our single NATO official. You know, they are thinking about the nuclear issues, and I think one of the problems we have today is that the Russian military clearly has a outsized role for their in mind for their tactical nuclear weapons in terms of their planning and their strategy, and this is a cause for great concern. There's also, of course, the issue that the Russians have violated the INF treaty and that they're not doing a very good job complying with arms control treaties, conventional or nuclear, almost across the board, as far as I am aware. So I think those are things that NATO itself has to tackle. The United States, here we've started to discuss some of this, certainly within the administration and within those the kind of community, nuclear community, but I don't even think it's been discussed very much on the Hill. I could be wrong. And certainly not in the American public writ large. So I want to make sure that was on the agenda. I don't have time to ask some of the other questions that I wanted to ask, but I can sort of provide some suggestion. Earlier I talked about enlargement. I think it's very important as we project our values. There are, I think it's now four nations waiting in line. First of all, very important, we should all take note, one of the most important things that we're going to do in Warsaw is to let in a new member, Montenegro. It's not a big country, but it's significant that the door, it demonstrates the door is open. Montenegro has done a lot of work in order to get ready to become a NATO member. Their work is not finished. They have much more work to do, as every NATO country does, really, including the United States. Once you're in, your work is never done. But that's something that we should celebrate as an alliance, and I believe we will. The other aspirants now are waiting, and they would like to make sure that they have a fair shot also at membership, and so I hope that that will also be a robust part of the agenda. Certainly for Georgia, which has had a big, and the ambassador sitting here with us in the front row, has had a huge outsized commitment to our NATO effort in Afghanistan and elsewhere, providing now the number two contingent in terms of numbers after the United States in Afghanistan. So we will take up enlargement also in Warsaw. And I felt like there was another one that I was going to mention, but in any event, those are a couple of the ones. Oh, hybrid. My understanding is that NATO now has a hybrid strategy. Timo might have talked about this earlier. But I think it would be incumbent upon NATO to do one of the things I think that Secretary Tauscher was hinting at when she talked about EU and NATO having to work more closely together in the hybrid realm to develop some kind of hybrid plan.